So allergic reactions, we'll go through the physiology here quickly, and then we'll get to the signs and symptoms. You guys are 17, 18 years old. Surely you know what allergic reaction is, right? So like it says up here, it's just a hypersensitivity to something. You can get what's called contact dermatitis, and that's a rash that they don't know what caused, really. I mean, you get a rash, and you go, wow, I have a small rash here. And, you know, if you're crazy enough to go to the doctor over a small rash, the doctor will look at it and go, well, that's just contact dermatitis. It's a localized reaction. You should have went to Walmart, got some Benadryl cream, and put some Benadryl cream on there, and it'll go away. It's just, but we don't know what caused the rash. Who cares? It's a rash, right? It's isolated, it's local. So you had a hypersensitivity to something. One time my wife washed my favorite blanket with my UT blanket with the different soap, I guess. And I was covered up watching football because it was cold. And I started itching all over the place. I lifted my shirt up and my belly was red. It was complete. I broke out. And then I went to the mirror and go, wow, I'm broke out all over my chest. But it was still a localized reaction. It wasn't a big deal. No, I didn't take Benadryl cream and rub it all over my belly. I took oral Benadryl, then went to sleep, and then the reaction was gone. By the time I woke up, hours later. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you have these hypersensitivity things, and these allergic reactions can occur anytime. You know, like most people are allergic to grass. Even though you don't have a big breakout when you roll around the grass, you still have a localized reaction. Most people are allergic to grass, I think. An anaphylactic reaction is more, it's not a localized reaction, it's more life-threatening. So an anaphylactic reaction would be that patient that's having trouble breathing. Their tongue swells up the size of a golf ball, bigger than a golf ball, right? Big old tongue swelling up, or they feel like their throat's closing. And then anaphylactic shock would be when their pressure drops, right? Causes the vasodilation not taken care of. That's why people that have like reactions allergic to peanuts or something like that, or bee stings, those people, you know, they're out playing golf and they're allergic to bee stings. I can guarantee you they have an EpiPen in their golf bag, you know, because they're allergic to bees. They're outside. You need to have an EpiPen. If they're not, then that could be a problem. But it is an immune response, and what happens is from this immune response, from this reaction, to this foreign substance, whatever that might be, okay, let's just use bee stings because that's pretty common, pretty popular. So the bee stings, okay, this foreign substance is called the antigen, and then the allergen, okay, is a type of antigen that provokes the reaction. So you have a foreign substance, you have this antigen, okay, the antigen enters the body, and it's an type of an allergen, okay, that causes the reaction. And it's just the immune response because the body builds up antibodies. So when the little bee stings us the first time, right, we build up antibodies to it. The second time, we still build up antibodies to the sting because it's a foreign substance. The body sends up little antibody warriors to go up there and fight off this foreign substance. And once we can't build up enough antibodies for that, then a reaction can take place. But we'll look at it. I have a picture here in a second that will explain everything. Okay. So the body can produce, what happens is, in response to the allergen, the body produces these IgEs, these globin, what's the I stand for? Immune globin something, right? IgE, that's why we have abbreviations. Right? So the IgE encounters the allergen, and then it triggers the immune response. So these meet up with the antibodies, and they cause this immune response. Again, which can cause the allergic reaction. So an excessive amount of allergens causes the reaction. Okay, we can have a localized reaction, or we can have a systemic reaction. Systemic would be system, so it would be the system is taking place. That's why you have a systemic reaction would be the swelling of the airway, the edema, shortness of breath, the wheezing, the bronchoconstriction. Okay. And then the first time, this is a little myth buster here, the first time the sensation, so let's say you've never been stung by a bee, you can't be allergic to bee stings necessarily. You have to have introduced that first. Once you're introduced to it, then you can have a response to it. This is the ones that produces the IgE. Now there's a reaction that doesn't produce the IgEs that you can have without the being sensitized to it, without having contact with it. Okay? And what happens is once these IgEs form up with the antibodies, then they hit to the cells. They hit a mast cell, which is the most popular, and the basophils, which are in the blood. And there's my picture that I was trying to get to. But forget this top part here because I couldn't find the picture I wanted in the clinch. Okay, so but this is what I want to look at here, because this is the reaction that takes place. These are the IgEs and then the antibodies, and once they form up, what they will do, they will look for a mast cell to attach to. And then once they attach to this mast cell, what happens then is it will release histamine. And once it releases the histamine, then all the bad things start to happen. The histamine is the thing that causes most of the signs and symptoms. There's other things that do this, but we're focused just mainly on the histamines that causes it. So the IgEs match up with the antibodies. They look for this mast cell. It causes this mast cell now to leak out the histamine. And then the histamine is what's going to cause the majority of the signs and symptoms that we're going to look at in this allergic reaction. You don't really need to... That's all good to know on how this allergic reaction takes place, okay? But it's not really necessary. The necessary thing to remember is the patient has an allergy. Let's say this patient has an allergy to bees, okay? They were outside without their EpiPen, and they got stung by a bee, and they're having an allergic reaction due to that bee. We know this because part of your assessment, once you do your ABCs and everything, you go up to the patient, and you're going to say, you know, hey, what's the problem today? Why don't you call 911? I got stung by a bee and I'm allergic to them. Okay? They're going to tell you that right away. Okay? So there's going to be a history. They're going to know that they're allergic to bees, or they've been exposed to that, whatever that, that they're allergic to, that they're sensitive to, they have that hypersensitivity to. And then we just release, so it just says here, to release chemicals, and we're okay with chemicals, but the primary one is histamine. There's other chemicals that are released, okay, but the histamine is the one that causes a lot of the problems that we talk about. So you can't really see this, but it's in your book, and I have to get closer to see it. So this, the bee caused all this. The patient got stung by the bee, allergic to bees, and then they start talking about bronchoconstriction, capillary permeability. What capillary permeability is that the capillaries start to leak. Maybe the channels open up, and they'll leak out fluid, which is going to cause edema, okay, localized edema, but they don't leak enough where they can get the bigger molecules out. They release some fluids and some proteins, so you get some edema with that. So the capillaries sort of start to leak. Vasodilation and increased mucus production. So they get a lot of mucus in their airways. They vasodilate, okay, potentially, not all the time. If they vasodilate, what's going to happen to their pressure? Yes, the pressure is going to drop. So you get this. Now, this could be a late sign, but I've seen it happen. I've seen a guy, he was allergic to gluten, and he ate a Danish. And he was hypotensive in about 5 minutes. 5 minutes later, we were intubating him and pumping him full of food because he was hypotensive. Shouldn't have ate the Danish, even though I taunted him to eat it, but he shouldn't have ate it. Okay? So these are what we get in the acute compromise, okay? We get the, and then we get the bronchoconstriction, the vasodilation, and then the airway. The patient feels like, hey, it feels like my throat is swelling shut. Some cool pictures coming up with some swelling, okay? Now you get these non-IEG, how would you say that word?
Anaphylactoid.
Wow, okay. So these are, don't give off the IEGs, but the signs and symptoms are the same. It doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things if they're having a, what, anaphylactoid or anaphylactic reaction. The signs and symptoms are the same, and we treat signs and symptoms, right? And trust me, you won't be worried about that when the patient's throat's swelling shut and they're in the process of dying because of a bee sting or something. That question won't come into your mind. So, allergens, just the way that they're introduced, injection, like the bee sting would be injection, a needle, like in a reaction to IV drug abuse, ingestion, plants, food, peanuts, right? Causes a bad reaction, inhalation, and then you contact it. We come in contact with something that you're allergic to. It's absorbed through the skin. And there's a laundry list of them, of things that could people have a reaction to. Antibiotics, it's not the same person, but the tongue was just as big. There's a picture coming up here with this person. I don't want to spoil it for you. But there's a picture of this tongue really swollen. That guy had to go into surgery. He was allergic. He had an allergic reaction to his antibiotics. Anyway, I've been to a dentist office where they've had an allergic reaction, a severe allergic reaction to Novocaine. The dentist sort of freaking out. Opioids, hormones. I mean, steroids. You keep going on and on with the list, medications, iodines for like CAT scans and stuff, different creams, almost everything, you know, that they're out there people can have a reaction to. Jellyfish, ouch. You know, they don't really do latex too much. Exercise, I'm allergic to exercise, oh no. And then sometimes they don't know what caused the reaction, okay? They just say there's a reaction for some reason. The size up is the same as any type of emergency, okay? The patient assessment is the same. Do your sample, your OPQRST. You probably want to do a rapid assessment because this patient could be having trouble breathing. Okay, severe trouble breathing could be critical. be aware of this, however, if let's say they, the call comes in, you have a 17-year-old female patient who was stung by multiple bees or wasps, okay?
Oh.
Is that scene safe? I mean, are the wasps gone? I mean, you have a wasp nest and you have 50, 60, whatever, gazillion wasps, okay? And the patient's still in the midst of all that. Would you go running? Yeah, you're spraying. Kill those dogs first. You know, no, that's actually fairly dangerous. I went on one and which with bees. This guy got stung by, I don't know, been too long now, but he probably got stung by 50, 60 bees. And that was one of the questions. Are the bees gone? You know what I mean? We're going to the scene and we're asking the dispatch, do you know about the bees? Are those things gone? Or is there a problem? You know, because if we go the same way, if we go in and we get stung by a bunch of bees, then we're not going to be able to help the patient either, right? So this guy, the bees were gone, so it wasn't a problem. But he had a problem.
What would you do exactly, like, if the bees or the wasps were still there?
We'd have to figure a way to get them cleared out. Yeah. Off the cuff, I would say that the fire department would be there. They could spray them away.
Like the water hose?
Yeah, hit them with water, get them off, spray them or something. You'd have to get the bees away. Same way as a dog. You know, a dog creates a potential hazard. Even if the owner says, oh, they won't buy it. Yeah, okay. Cujo will bite you. You always be cautious of dogs. But the bees are the same way. Is it really safe or some other thing that they're having a reaction to? You know, when we go into hazmat, our chapter on hazmat, we'll talk about a bunch of things, but you got to sort of think before you go into these things. Okay. So, good general impression. How's the patient doing? The alert. Is this causing, they have a lot of hoarseness? Can they talk? You know, are there signs of airway constriction? If there's signs of airway constriction, then that would be the time that you would need ALS, right? Mm-hmm. Because that airway could close up quick, very quick, and then you have a completely obstructed airway, and you would need ALS there to do a surgical top airway, where the patient's going to die if you don't do that. These reactions happen very quickly, so these are the times that you're making the big bucks. You have to make the quick decisions, right? So stridor, or they have an upper airway obstruction. This would all be something that you would take in on your general impression. Say, okay, I probably need ALS on this. Okay, wheezing, carry the EpiPen. Do I need to bag this patient? How are they being ventilated? Is there SpO2 up there? How's all this look? Okay, always consider ALS. They could be going into anaphylactic shock fairly quickly. Okay, so do I need to prepare for that? Edema, hives, itching. So, have you guys ever seen anybody with like a really bad allergic reaction? Did you guys see that in the hospital? Any?
Big tongue.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Big old tongue.
Yeah.
So.
Oh yeah, I think I was with you that
day.
It's
yeah.
Problematic when you get airway obstructions. Like this guy, he would suction himself. He was alert enough. That little tongue sticking out there. He was just drooling everywhere. He would take the Yonkers and just suction himself for a while. They gave him a lot of medicine. It just wouldn't help. They took this guy into surgery. They were going to put a surgical airway in him because his tongue wasn't going down and it was causing an airway obstruction. Oh, there she is.
Mm-hmm.
That big tongue. That's an airway obstruction. Okay. So not only that, but it looks bad, right? But so you walk up on this, this is your general impression. You walk up on that patient, you automatically should be thinking, oh, let's do ALS here. That's she needs Benadryl, which is not an EMT drug, right? She's probably going to need some epi, but she definitely has an airway problem that you can't correct. Just some urticaria, such a strange word, but it means hives. So everybody in the world calls it hives. Nobody calls it urticaria, but that's the medical term. So if you see that term here, they're just talking about hives, right? Just reaction from the drugs. Now, if that's all it is, if there's no other reaction except this, that's still a localized reaction unless they're having difficulty breathing with it, unless they're having other signs and symptoms. So if this presents here, the baby obviously wearing a diaper, or an old person that has to wear a diaper, but if that's all it is here, and they're no difficulty breathing, no respiratory distress, no pressure problems, no heart rate problems, okay? This would be a localized reaction. Even though it's big, it's covering the entire interior thorax and abdomen, right? But it's still a localized reaction. It only becomes a really big problem when they start having trouble breathing with it. And the other more, you know, weak pulse, trouble breathing, stridor, these things, more serious signs and symptoms. And then just some spotty reaction, okay? A food allergy. We had this one lady that was allergic to shell food. What was her favorite restaurant to eat?
So sorry.
Yeah, well, it's close. Red Lobster. Yeah, allergic to shell food, and she ate at Red Lobster. That was where she went. We could hear her wheezing coming down the hall. And then she checked into the ER. She walked into the ER. We could hear her wheezing, and we're going, oh, that's the lady. That's the Red Lobster lady. And she'd done this several times, but she didn't make it through that one. She ended up going into cardiac arrest because she didn't want to stop eating whatever she ate, lobster or something. But you could hear it. She was wheezing away. So and it doesn't take very long either for these type of reactions to take place. Other things you might see, rhinitis, runny nose, okay, tachycardia, cough, itching, faintness, know that they're allergic to whatever they came in contact with, hives, edema. So what you have to do is just be prepared to, hey, we're going to have to transport this patient. Rapid transport in case there's more of a problem. So if they're having these, tachycardia and syncopal episodes, you know, who cares if their nose is running or if their tongue is bulging out of their mouth, right? Then you're going to have to put those facts together and say, yeah, we're going to have rapid transport. If you need immediate intervention, then you have your EpiPen, correct? Epinephrine, the beta 2 properties of the epinephrine causes the bronchodilation, correct? What other property helps that's in epinephrine? The beta 1, what does that do? Oh no, it will increase heart rate. I'm sorry, beta 1 will increase the heart rate, okay? So you're gonna have an increase in heart rate.
It will also increase the blood pressure.
The alpha effects of epinephrine. It will increase pressure because it's going to increase heart rate. So you have the beta 1, right, which is the heart. So epinephrine is going to increase the heart rate. Okay, the beta 2 lungs it's going to cause bronchodilation, and then the alpha effects, it's going to cause vasoconstriction, right? Why is that handy? Why is the vasoconstriction handy?
Because they can possibly, during a reaction, they can have vasodilation.
Right. You can have vasodilation. So we hit the EpiPen, and it sort of covers all the bases, right? So this person that needs this EpiPen, yeah, it's going to increase their heart rate. Not a big issue there. Increased heart rate is going to help with the cardiac output somewhat, right? Bronchodilate, because that's part of the problem. Their bronchioles are constricted. Histamines are constricting their bronchioles, right? And then just in case they start going towards the anaphylactic shock because of the vasodilation, we vasoconstrict them, correct? So epinephrine's a good drug for that. What's the dose? For allergic reactions? What about a pediatric dose?
0.15.
Very important that you know your dosages of your medications. Okay? So, what about nitro, since we're on the subject?
0.4 milligrams.
0.4 milligrams, good. What route?
Oral.
Sublingual.
Oh,
what about epi? How's it given?
Subcutaneous.
Right, sub-Q. Right. So that the EpiPen, even though the needle's this long, it's designed to go through pants. So you give the epinephrine injection, and it's given sub-Q. Okay. Some that don't have the epinephrine injection, then you would draw the epinephrine up and give it sub-Q, right? If that was in your protocol. So nasal congestion, runny nose, laryngeal edema, that's where you get the throat, the larynx, okay? It starts to swell back here in the throat, and you get the excessive mucus production. Bronchoconstrictions don't cause the wheeze. If you get to the anaphylactic shock, then it's going to cause the hypotension, okay? The tachycardia, they're trying to maintain cardiac output, so the body's going to increase the heart rate for that. Okay. Edema from increased capillary permeability. So you have a capillary here. Say, okay, you have all kinds of fluid, water, all kinds of fluid floating through the capillaries. And then you have proteins through there, and you have certain size of proteins, certain size of cells, right? And in these capillaries, there's little gates in there, and due to certain pressures that we're not going to go into, but certain pressures, things will leak in and out to maintain the net concentration, right? To maintain net concentration of this vessel. So things can leak in and out. What will leak out is if it's increased in here, will be the water, things that can fit through these gaps, right? Which will cause edema in the interstitial, in the tissue. And then some of these smaller, let's say we have a small cell here or something, or small protein. And that small protein will leak out with the water, okay? And when that does, it will draw more water out of there. Right? So we get this edema. Itchy eyes, runny eyes and nose from the histamine. Like back before my cat's life ended. Every time I got close to the cat, petted Simon, my eyes would water up, my nose would run and it would itch and my eyes would itch because of the fact that I was allergic to little kitty. Okay? Hadn't had that problem in a while. But so it causes some side effects, but that's just pet reactions to the pet dander, right? Anyway, you do get some, later you do get some neurological stuff, dizziness, headaches, okay, along with the reaction. Always and forever, study these charts and look through these charts, okay? Especially for test, because what will happen is they go to these things and they pull out test questions out of here. This is where your scenarios are going to come from here. They're going to look at these charts and build scenarios out of it. Okay? Just the same way with respiratory on adequate breathing, inadequate breathing. They're going to build their test questions out of there. Everybody does that. So just a side note. Okay, so the same, hey, do your secondary assessment, do a good head-to-toe, good physical exam, OPQRST sample all the time. Right? There are some questions that you ask, hey, are these consistent with allergic reactions? Is it a mild allergic reaction where I don't really have to worry about it too much? Is it localized? Is it moderate? What I consider a moderate allergic reaction is when the patient is starting to wheeze. All right, they get the bronchoconstriction. They're having trouble breathing. Any respiratory problems at all, I consider that sort of a moderate allergic reaction. This is when your epinephrine is going to kick in, right? For the wheeze, this is when you need to be thinking about the EpiPen. The severe allergic reaction is when they have pressure problems. That's like what categories I put in. Giving them the medication, but are they getting worse? Is their body responding to the medication or not? They have a history. If they can speak, this would be one of the first things that they're telling these different things. Are they taking anything new for the allergies? So good questions, trying to find out as much.
You can't breathe, right?
Yeah. I've seen that before. Patient can't breathe. I mean, they're having severe respiratory distress, and my partner wants to ask them a bunch of questions, and they can't breathe. I'm like, come on, man, let's fix the breathing problem first, okay? They're all constricted. You hear these expiratory wheezes, and he wants to know last time they ate. Who cares? When was the last time they ate, right? Give them the epi. Fix the main problems first before you worry about all these questions. Okay. Have they had one in the past? Have they had this allergic reaction to the bees before? When was the last time? Do they have any other illnesses that might play a problem with that? Then you just go into the onset, because it is important to know what the onset, how long has this reaction been taking place, and what you were you exposed to, is that exposure still around? And then just look at break it down into your good assessment on the different systems, skin, respiratory, cardiovascular, right, neurological system, break down and look at those different systems as you collect your signs and symptoms. Always maintain good baseline vital signs, because if the patient goes where they're having an anaphylactic shock and you don't have good set of vital signs, then you won't know where you started, correct? Okay, so make sure that audible wheezing, like we talked about, rate, always on the pulse rate. Remember, rate, rhythm, pressure. Okay, so and then big time, is the airway compromised? You'll have airway compromise because that's something that you're very limited to, okay? Your airway adjunct won't help. An OPA or an NPA, it won't help if their airway shuts and closes off, okay? That just won't help. And are there signs that this patient could go in anaphylactic shock? Is that true? Like I said, minutes to some hours involvement, just depends on what it is. Medications, you sort of see a little bit longer time, over a couple of hours maybe, they're having this reaction. Foods, over time, a lot of times it takes a little bit of time for that to take place. Evaluate the need for oxygen. More than likely, in this scenario, this allergic reaction scenario, they're going to need be oxygenated, sometimes ventilated, right? And then look for signs of shock, always. Suction, remember the lady with the big tongue? She's going to need constant suctioning. You can choke on your own spit, right? Yeah, you can build up enough saliva where you can choke on your own spit. You need to keep that suctioned out. That's a big airway concern. It was with this guy that we took care of for a while. He would, of course, he was nice enough to suction himself, but it isn't airway concern. Always be prepared to ventilate the patient, okay, especially an allergic reaction. And then, like we talked about already, consider ALS. Initiate transport early, because you're not really sure how long the reaction's going to take. So go ahead and get the transport going. Don't wait around too much. You really want to transport or not, transport early, because you don't want to wait and then all of a sudden the patient's airway starts to close, and then you have a bigger problem, right? Reassess, good. Let's go back down through ABCs, vital signs. See if it's the reaction's progressing. Maybe this reaction started out that localized reaction. Okay, it's on the belly. And then now, 5 minutes later, it's running up the patient's neck into the patient's face. Right? So it's starting to progress a little bit. So the reaction's getting a little bit worse. So those are things that you want to keep an eye on, because they do take place really quick. A biphasic or late stage reaction, okay? Hopefully that late stage reaction, we're already at the hospital. But they could wait, the patient could wait, right? So you could get there in the latter part of the reaction. Maybe the patient's having the allergic reaction, okay? They take their Benadryl, they take their Epi, and they wait, and they wait, and they wait, okay? And then they call, like an asthmatic will. Asthmatic will take their inhaler, they take their inhaler again, they keep trying that, and then time you get there, you're late in that respiratory problem. The same way here, you could show up in sort of the late phase of it. The biggest thing, like all this, is to recognize the problems, right? Recognize, hey, just like any of the medical emergencies, recognize that the person's having a heart attack. Recognize that they're having a respiratory difficulty, right? That they're having diabetic problems. So recognition is huge, and it doesn't change with the allergic reactions. Right, so here's what we talked about. Beta-1 side effects, increased heart rate. Beta-2, bronchodilation. Alpha effects causes the vasoconstriction. 0.3 milligrams. And this gives a pounds, okay? and 0.15 for less than 66 pounds. How many kilograms is that? How many kilograms is 66 pounds?
Kilograms?
One pound equals how many kilograms?
I don't know.
What have they been teaching you in chemistry?
Well, yeah, but we learned that in sophomore year.
One pound equals 2.2 kilograms? Or is it the other way? 1 kilogram equals 2.2 pounds.
Well, usually what
One pound equals 0.454
One pound equals... A little.
25 kilograms.
Yeah, because every time
kilograms is more like kilograms. It has a less numerical value than pounds.
So it's 66 pounds equals 30 kilos, right? You know, the way that you can figure this out is that, let's say we used to do the math easy, 140 pound patient weighs 70 kilos plus 10%. So the 110% of 140 is what? So half plus 10%. If you don't want to completely do the math, half it. So it's 140 pound patient is 70 kilos. That's close enough.
Okay.
But if you want to be exact, then you add the 10%. So 2.2 pounds. Is it 2.2 pounds? Yeah, 2.2 pounds equals 1 kilogram. Right?
Probably like...
But we'll go... We'll stick with the pounds. But the reason that you convert it...
2.205.
Hmm?
2.2.
Yeah, 1 pound, 2.2.
No, 1 kilogram equals...
1 kilogram equals 2.2 pounds. The reason you go to kilograms is when you do your pharmacology, everything was measuring milligrams per kilogram. So you need to understand that conversion. Everything is measured. Medicine is measured in milligrams per kilogram. Alright. Especially pediatric medicine. Alright. There's your EpiPen. Okay, but you have an adult pen, which is 0.3 milligrams, the child pen, which is 0.15 milligrams, okay? Same thing, same procedure, remove the cap. The procedure-wise, you know, make sure it's their epinephrine, right? Make sure it's in day, just like you've given any medication. Remove the cap. Stab the orange end into the thigh, hold it for 10 seconds, and then release it. The needle will automatically go up into the barrel. If needed, it can be repeated. One thing that you have to be cautious with epi is with old people, it can induce a heart attack. Okay. Side effects of epi: dizziness, chest pain, headache, tachycardia. I do get a little excited with it. Like if there's nothing wrong with you at all, you could take 0.3 milligrams of epi at your age, and your heart rate would go up, you'd feel a little jittery for a little bit, and that would be, you could breathe better, right? And the bronchodilation pressure may go up a little bit, right? No big deal. You give that same 0.3 milligrams to a 70-year-old, you're probably going to induce a heart attack. And so you have to be very careful with epi. Pretty easy, right? Pretty straightforward. Signs and symptoms, treatment, vocabulary. We'll be good. Okay.